This podcast is sponsored by nobody.
Hey, dudes. This is Catherine Mary Stewart, Maggie in The Last Starfighter, and Reggie in Night of the Comet. And you're listening to Tommy Throwback Kovac in Splat from the Past. And remember, the whole burden of civilization has fallen upon us.
Hey, dudes! Welcome to Splat from the Past, the only 80s-themed horror sci-fi show where things can get totally radical. Now today, I will be welcoming back my good friend Catherine Mary Stewart for the seventh time, and we're going to nerd out on the entertainment of our youth. You know, she grew up in Canada, and she spent some time in London during her college years, and I want to find out, you know, like what her entertainment was growing up into early adulthood, and it's going to be a great conversation today. I just love Kathy. She's one of my favorite guests and one of my favorite people in the world, favorite regulars for that matter. And it's going to be a great conversation. See if she's got any new movies coming up or convention appearances so you can all go and meet her. And tonight I will drop Ask Tommy number 4, where I answer frequently asked questions from listeners and guests. So keep your eyes peeled for that. It's going to be spectacular. So yeah, here is my new interview with Catherine Mary Stewart. Hey, Kathy, welcome back. How's your March 1st so far?
Oh, good. Yeah, very good. March 1st is good. I haven't spoken to you for a long time.
Yeah, it's been a while. Last time we talked was my anniversary conversation episodes I was doing. Yeah. Well, once spring hits, I'll be excited because we might be having a storm today.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, what is it, Modesto? Is that what it says?
Yeah, Modesto.
Nice.
Yeah, we might be having a storm later today, but hey, you know, it happens every now and then.
It does. Storms happen.
So, going back in time, can you remember the first movie that had an impact on you?
I saw it on television with a bunch of friends of mine. It was a sleepover. We were like, I don't know, 8 years old or something like that. Mm-hmm. And we put The Birds on. Sitting down in the basement of my friend's house, we were watching this thing, which totally freaked us out.
Yeah.
You know, we were sort of like, after seeing that, we were like, what if this really did happen and birds started attacking us for no reason? So that was sort of the most impact. That was sort of like my first horror movie, I want to say. And yeah. It was scary for a little kid. You know, I think it was, I don't know, when was The Birds?
1963.
Like 1963 or something like that.
Right.
Yeah. I remember also the first movie that I ever went to in a theater. My parents took me for some odd reason. It was called Hot Millions.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of that movie?
What's it called again?
Hot Millions.
No.
Yeah. It was like this weirdo movie. I don't know why my parents thought I would have any of the flicking up.
Yeah.
It's an adult movie, you know. It was an adult in that, it was just really boring for a little kid. And I was very, very young. And yeah, so that was the first movie that I saw in a theater. It starred Peter Ustinov. Probably, my parents wanted to see it, and I guess they couldn't get a babysitter or something.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, seeing this man, Peter Ustinov, I don't know if you're familiar with him.
Of course.
But seeing him on the big screen, I was like, oh my God, it's a movie star. So that was sort of, Peter Ustinov was my first movie crush.
Oh my God.
I know. How pathetic is that?
I mean, at least you were progressive. I mean, you know, for the superficial culture we live in now, I don't think anyone would have a crush on Peter Ustinov.
I don't think so. I was into, like, a sophisticated older guy, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the only person I was exposed to. So it was like, I don't know, it's just weird. It's very weird in retrospect, but those are a couple of the very first ones. And I also remember Mom and Dad took me to 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Yeah.
Which I just was, like, suicidal in that one. The only part that I liked, I mean, I was a little kid, 2001, like, 58, so, like, I was, like, eight. And watching this movie, I didn't know what it was about. It was so deep. Weird, you know.
Yeah.
Such a strange movie. People are still trying to figure out what it all means to this day. As an 8-year-old, it was like, what? The only part I remember really liking is when the monkeys came on and started, you know.
I interviewed one of those monkeys last year. And we were talking about the movie and, like, what the movie means. And, like, you know, the conclusion that Kubrick was trying to make was that it was a metaphor for, you know, how we are born. You know, what if we're not born in heaven? What if we're born in space?
No. That was a metaphor. Okay. You know, I don't know what it's about. I've watched it since, and I'm still not quite sure what it's about, but whatever.
Yeah.
that seems a little simplistic somehow, but what do I know? I mean, made this, you know, such a, special effects wise, it was so ahead of its time.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm a little bit younger, but, like, Back to the Future was, like, the first movie I saw where I was like, this is a perfect movie, because, you know, just like, you know, most people who love the movie, I have that fantasy of going back in time and seeing my parents in high school and finding out why I'm so fucked up and why they're so fucked up, you know?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, you and I, I don't know how old you are, but we're
40.
So off from each other, but it is funny how movies that we see as children have such a huge influence on us.
Yeah. Did Canada have new network affiliates of NBC, CBS, and ABC when you were a kid?
Well, I grew up in Canada.
Yeah.
So we, I guess it was mostly like, especially when I was growing up, which was basically the 60s and the 70s, mm-hmm. I don't really remember seeing American television. Sometimes there was... You would get American shows on, like, CBC or something like that.
Yeah.
We had our own station. We had, like, ETV, which was the local station. We had CBC, which was pretty much everything else. So, I remember watching something like The Carol Burnett Show or all those variety shows. That from those days, which I really loved, Sonny and Cher.
Yeah.
I really loved the variety shows, and then we would watch, you know, I don't know, the Mary Tyler Moore Show or something like that was a real favorite.
Right.
We also watched, like, a ton of, I mean, I was looking at all the little kid shows from the 60s and 70s that I would have been watching. It's so funny. I mean, we had somebody called Mr. Dress-Up, who is basically a takeoff of, Welcome to My Neighborhood Guy.
Oh, Mr. Rogers.
Yeah, Mr. Rogers. So we had Mr. Dress-Up, which was Mr. Rogers, basically the Canadian version.
Yeah.
I mean...
Did you have, like, a Howdy Doody type of a show host?
I don't remember. We had somebody called the Gentle Giant or something like that, and he had puppets. But he was, like, supposedly this giant, And he had a castle, and he would invite you to come in and sit down in these little chairs that were the size of his hand. And then he had these puppets, Jerome the giraffe, and he had this rooster, Rusty the rooster, and they would come, and Jerome would stick his head in the castle window because he was so tall. the friendly giant is what that was called. That was one of my favorite ones. And there was this other one called, like, the Park Rangers or something like that, which was a bunch of kids. Or the Forest Rangers. It was a bunch of kids who were, like, junior forest rangers, and they would go out and solve all these problems, you know, in the wilds of Canada. I love that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like me, you're a Monkees fan, but did you watch all the other, like, American sitcoms, like, you know, the Addams Family and the Munsters and stuff like that?
We had, I don't remember seeing the Addams Family, but we did watch the Munsters, and I love the Munsters.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, me and my dad was born in 57, so I watched a lot of the old stuff that he grew up watching with him.
Yeah.
We watched Batman and My Three Sons and Hogan's Heroes and Gilligan's Island and the Brady Bunch and the Partridge Family and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah, we got all that stuff. Yeah, that was very, very good. I loved those things. Batman, you know, you look back at Batman when it, and it's so... It was so funny that when they turned it into, like, this really dramatic kind of movie, it was like, wait, no, Batman's funny.
Growing up a tomboy with brothers, did you watch sports on TV?
Well, being in Canada, it was hockey night in Canada. Every Saturday night, we'd eat dinner in front of the television and watch hockey. Well, during hockey season, obviously. But, yeah, big-time hockey fans.
Wow. Yeah, let's see. I know some shows that were filmed in Canada in the 70s. Let's see if you remember any of these. Do you remember The Star Lost?
Star Lost? No. When was that shot?
That was in 1972, and Kerr DeLay from 2001 A Space Odyssey was the star. It was a Star Trek ripoff. He was a star in the States for a while, and then he left and went back to Canada, where he's from, and started doing a lot of stuff over there, and this was one of the earliest things he did.
Gosh, I don't remember that one at all. That's so weird.
How about the hilarious House of Dr. Frightenstein?
That was a cartoon, right?
No. This was a sketch comedy horror show with Vincent Price narrating, and Billy Van was Dracula, and Mitch Markowitz was one of the supporting ghouls. I interviewed him a couple years ago. He was Doug Henning's manager, and his brother had had all these failures as a producer, and then he called him up and said, hey, can you get off the road with Doug? I need a hit. And so they came up with this show, and it was a huge hit in Canada. It was only on for like a year, 71 to 72, but like it's got a huge cult success over here in the States.
Oh, you're kidding me.
Yeah, it's huge.
No,
yeah.
I don't know it at all. It's so bizarre.
You know, go on YouTube. It's there.
I believe you. Yeah. Yeah. I'm just looking through, like, early on stuff that I was watching. I mentioned a couple of them to you already. We weren't allowed also, by the way. You know, we weren't really allowed to watch a lot of television.
Uh-huh.
No, because it's like anything nowadays. Your mom has been... too much time on your phone playing all those games. It seems the thing. But back in the day when I was growing up, you know, I'd get home from school and my mother was out or something like that, and I would turn the TV on and watch Days of Our Lives or something, because the soap operas would come on in the late afternoon after school, and then all the kids would be talking about them. So I had to, like, you know, watch what had been going on. But if I heard... Our garage was attached to the house, and we could hear the electric door go up. So as soon as I heard the door go up, I had to turn off the TV and run upstairs to my room and pretend I was, like, doing my homework or something. So my mom caught on pretty quickly. She was literally, my mother would literally feel the television to see if it was warm.
Yeah. Yeah. Were you an SCTV fan?
Pardon me?
Were you an SCTV fan?
Oh, yeah, SCTV was good. It was sort of later in my experience, but yeah, I loved SCTV.
Oh, God, it was brilliant. I mean, it still continues to influence generations of comedians. The stuff they got away with. Like, they did a Leave It to Beaver parody where it's like 25 years later, Ward is an old drunk, Eddie Haskell is gay, Beaver shoots Eddie. It's so funny.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That was another one when I was very young. I remember, like, my mother was working, and we would have to go over to my grandma's house, and she would let us watch Leave It to Beaver in her basement, and yeah. I was probably 5 years old, maybe four, watching Leave It. I just thought it was the greatest thing ever. Again, like, my parents were very strict about how much TV we watched, so that was a real super treat to get to watch Leave It to Beaver.
Yeah, it still holds up. I met him last year at a convention. He's a very shy, very reserved guy. And I got an 8x10 of him of when he's in that big old coffee cup. Remember that episode?
Yeah. And the weird thing is, it's so sad. I mean, we grew up with all these theories that you really become sort of committed to and addicted to. And now, I mean, TV just isn't TV. I guess on something like Netflix or something, you could stream series.
Right.
But it was such a cultural sort of routine thing. Like, I remember Thursday nights were always a really good night for TV. Saturday, on Saturday nights we would watch hockey. And then on Sundays, my mom would let us watch something special on TV with some popcorn and a pop. But it was all very regimented and very strict, but still there was something so special about, you know, oh, I can't wait for Thursday night once, you know, I don't know, whatever the show was at the time. But, you know, Mary Tyler Moore or something like that, like I mentioned earlier.
Yeah. Going back to the movies, do you remember your first drive-in experience?
Drive-in. It might have been drive-in. That's a good question. It might have been Jaws.
Nice.
I know. It might have been Jaws, and we went and saw that. And my dad was a marine biologist, so.
Yep.
He sort of watched it with, like, that would never happen kind of a thing. So that dated me. It's so funny because so many people are freaked out about sharks and Jaws and
yeah.
never swim in the ocean again. And I was just like, you know, sort of reflecting what my dad said. It's like, that would never happen. Sharks are, in general, animals are more afraid of us than we are of them.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very pragmatic with my sort of opinion, I guess, of Jaws, but I remember seeing that on the big screen with my dad, and I think it might have been a drive-in.
Yeah, my parents started taking me when I was two, and it got to a point where they had to stop taking me for 3 years because I was always falling asleep in the back seat, or I was getting out of the car and knocking on windshields or something like that.
Getting into trouble.
Yeah, and I can remember the first time I ever saw Charlie Chaplin. My mom took me to the snack bar to complain about something, and I see this cookie ad with Charlie Chaplin on it. It was like a cardboard poster. It was for Bagley's cookies, and I was like, hey, Mommy, I want a cookie just like that man has. And she's like, no, you don't get a cookie. I'm mad.
Aww. I'm mad right now. I'm taking it out on you, damn it.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my God. That's like one of those experiences you don't forget. But did you ever see The Rail Rodder? Rail Rodder, 1965. It was Buster Keaton's last movie, and it was shot in Canada.
Oh, I you should. Is that the one that was the real?
The real Roger.
That wasn't the one about that was sort of an ad for Canada Travel, was it?
I'm sure I remember.
Look that up. I just finished this Buster Keaton book called The Cameraman.
Yeah.
And it's his movies are all mentioned in there. And there's this one that he did late in life in Canada, and it was let's see.
He plays like a guy who's always hopping on trains, you know. He's like a railway motor car guy.
Yeah.
It was a short film too. It was 24 minutes.
I think we're thinking of the same thing. For the rail rider.
The rail Roger. R O D D E R. Roger.
Roger. The rail Roger.
Yeah.
Railroader, the short.
Yeah.
I think it's the same one I'm thinking of. And it literally was created as a way to advertise travel in Canada.
Yeah, it was
he starts on this small, one of those little, I don't know, railroad cars that are you just sort of sit on and you travel along in the. And he goes all the way across Canada. He starts on the East Coast, and he goes all the way across to the West Coast.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes. And I interviewed the director a couple of years ago, Gerald Potterton. He died a year ago. And a couple of years ago, I talked to him. You know, he comes from animation. He did the animation for the Beatles' Yellow Submarine movie, and he directed Heavy Metal. And, yeah, he was just telling me about, you know, his relationship with Buster and about how, you know, he burned so many bridges in Hollywood that he couldn't get a movie made there no more, so he had to go to Canada in his last years.
Yeah, well, it's a very, very, like I said, I just finished this biography about him, and it's a very complicated story, but when he was asked to do this, it was like, why not? I'll do that. He's a really interesting character. I mean, he did burn bridges to a certain degree because he went through a tough period of being an alcoholic and all of this, but it's incredible how many series that he worked on.
Yeah.
Remember the guy, Red Skelton?
Oh, yes. Red Skelton was a clown.
He was a clown, but he was Buster Keaton was a huge influence on him.
Oh, yeah.
And he wrote for him in his series, and Buster Keaton did a lot of stuff behind the scenes, too, writing and all that other stuff. He worked right up until the very end. He died quite young, actually, with lung cancer, but, he did that movie, and it was incredible.
Yeah, I mean, I love all those silent comedian guys, Chaplin and Keaton and Harold Lloyd. He did that short where he's hanging off of that clock tower.
Oh, incredible. Incredible stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It is amazing. I've been really, over the last few years, really fascinated with the early... I mean, these people really, literally... created the movie industry.
Yeah.
And were so hugely powerful and influential back in the day. I mean, he had his own studio and everything. He was making his own movies. He was in them. He was directing them. He choreographed them. You know, he was just such an... He grew up as on stage with his parents. Just full, it was incredible for the shows they would do where his dad would like throw him around the stage and stuff. That's how he learned how to do all those stunts and things that he does. I mean, that's him doing everything.
Oh, yeah. Finding out about all that vaudeville stuff is great. There's a writer named Cliff Nesteroff. He's from Canada. He was a stand-up comic for years who couldn't really get arrested doing stand-up, so he started writing about comedy books, and he's written a lot of fascinating stuff where he's, like, going back into, like, vaudeville, Borscht Belt, and like, beyond, and just dissecting the truth about certain situations that that happened in comedy, like, you know, comedians getting canceled long before, you know, that term existed. Like Von Meter, you know, he got canceled because he was doing impressions of Kennedy, and he became famous when Kennedy was alive. But then a year later, when Kennedy died, that was it. People stopped booking him. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a tough business, as we know.
Yeah. It's very tough. It's very tough. Do you remember the first album you ever bought with your own money?
The first album. Ooh, music album, huh?
Yeah.
With my own money. Well, it would have been something like Eagles, probably.
Wow.
But it would have been something like the Eagles, because I'm a huge Eagles fan.
Yeah.
And yeah, we used to buy tons of records and things, and back in the day when you actually would play a whole record and you would know all the songs. We would learn all the songs on the A side and the B side, and it was just a whole different thing. And now my kids listen to, I don't know, whatever it is you stream music on. I mean, you hear one song, they seem to remember them all, but it's like, there's something, again, when I would come home after school at night, if I wasn't watching the soap opera, I'd put on a record and just learn every word of every song, and just sing at the top of my lungs in the living room next to the record player. I just loved all that so much. I remember the very first album, a rock album that I heard. Because in my family on Sundays, we would get up and my mom would make brunch, and my dad would put on some music, and it was either classical or something like Burl Ives, you know, something like that.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember looking at all the records. I was always fascinated by record covers and things like that. I came across the Beatles, and it was Rubber Soul.
Love it.
And I pulled it out, and I'm like, oh, because it was kind of like, what? This record, and it was my dad's, and it was very like edgy for my, I felt like, and it was, we did play it, but it was like, we really expose our children to this rock and roll, and
yeah.
Of course, I know every word from that album. That was the first rock and roll album I ever came across.
Oh, yeah, my dad had that record. He had a big old box of vinyl records. He had the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Rod Stewart, James Taylor, Fleetwood Mac, Foreigner. I mean, he had everything. You know, I'm glad that vinyl is making a comeback, because there's nothing like that stinky, musky smell of vinyl. It's so intoxicating.
Oh, a vinyl's great, yeah. The only drag is that you can scratch it. But, I mean, you know, it's fun. My son has, my dad is a big record collector too. He has so many albums. And then every variety from classical to blues to just everything. My son, who's really into jazz, has a bunch of his albums, like from the 50s. And stuff like that, yeah. So that's pretty cool. He bought himself a turntable, it is. It's coming back as a thing, so that's good.
Yeah. I love the Canadian rock bands, like The Guess Who, April Wine, Rush, Triumph, Bachman Turner Overdrive, Moxie, Chilliwack. Yeah, lots of good ones.
Chilliwack, yeah. yeah, for sure. And obviously, being in Canada, we grew up with all that music. We had a sort of a different version. A lot of, like, American albums, too, came filtered through England.
Yeah.
Somehow. So it's interesting. We got sometimes a slightly different variety, but Sure, all those bands, man. They were big. They were big there in Canada. Well, of course, we were exposed to lots of the American stuff too.
Yeah. When you were in London, did you, like, you know, get into any of the punk and new wave bands? Did you, like, go to British pubs and see them?
I loved British pubs, but I didn't really go. You know, when I was living in England, I was pretty young. I was there by myself, and I didn't really, like, do that scene at all. I have to say, I've never really latched on to the whole punk scene. Mm-hmm. So, I didn't is the answer.
Yeah, do you remember your first concert?
I do. This will be, I wonder if you even know who this is. I went to a concert with Gino Vanelli. Mm-hmm. You know who Gino Vanelli is?
I've heard the name.
He's like a Canadian-Italian, I believe. Canadian.
There's lots of Canadian Italians out there.
What's that?
There's lots of Canadian Italians out there.
Yeah, Canadian rock singer. Yeah, big. So I remember. I loved his music, and I thought he was pretty cute too. So that was my first concert. I have to say, I didn't go to a ton of concerts, but that was the first one I went to, and I loved it.
Oh, I know who he is. He did "I Just Want to Stop."
I just want to stop.
Yeah.
Tell you how I feel about you, babe. I just want to stop.
Yep.
Where they wrong with that today? Yeah.
Wow. And he had a nice little fro there back in the 70s.
Yes, he did. Sure did. Huge fro.
I had two first concerts. I saw Steppenwolf at our county fair, and John Kay was the only original member, and it didn't matter because he's very charismatic and a real showman. And then I saw Alice Cooper 2 years later at the Warfield in San Francisco, and he is a real showman. I mean, he completely just put on a good show, destroyed the place. It was fantastic.
Destroyed the place. I love it. Yeah, it's fun. I mean... Good times. Yeah, I remember high schools like Supertramp and Pink Floyd and...
The progressive rock bands.
Yeah, I loved it. I loved all that.
The Moody Blues, Jethro Tull.
Yeah.
Genesis. How about comedy records?
Comedy records? We had a few Bill Cosby comedy records.
Yeah, because he was family friendly.
What's that?
Because he was family friendly.
Back when he was LG, he was hilarious. Yeah, we used to listen to some of those. And Harry Seacon, there's some hilarious English groups, Peter Sellers and Harry Seacon.
Yeah.
They have some hilarious albums that we used to just so funny, just hilarious. Very, very, very British humor.
Oh, yeah. We had Lily Tomlin's This Is a Recording, and my mom loved her. She'd play it all the time. And we had Cheech and Chong's Big Bamboo, and we had a Richard Pryor album, but I can't remember which one because we only had the record and not the cover for some reason.
You had only the record and not the cover, okay.
Yeah, someone must have stolen it. You know, it was like in a jacket, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I just looked this up too. I have to look everything up. It's been a long time. But the Goon Show. It was called The Goon Show on BBC.
Uh-huh.
And it was with Spike Milligan, Harry Seacombe, Peter Sellers. So funny.
Wow.
Ridiculously funny. We listened to that kind of stuff, which is fun.
Yeah, I'm a big Monty Python fan and Benny Hill and all of that.
Oh, yeah. Monty Python is just so funny. So silly and funny and unique.
Geniuses. They're all geniuses.
Geniuses, absolutely. absolutely.
Do you remember the first song you ever made out to?
The first song. Afternoon Delight.
Oh, was that the Starland Vocal Band?
I'm gonna have some afternoon delight.
Starland Vocal Band, oh my God.
Isn't that hilarious? I remember we were making out, and I'm like, this is a little too spot on, I feel like.
Yeah, there's a Simpsons episode where Homer has a tattoo of the Starland Vocal Band, and he got it and doesn't even remember it.
Oh my God, that's hilarious. That is hilarious.
Yeah, oh my God. I saw your first movie recently, Powderheads.
That was my second movie, my friend.
Oh, it was?
That's correct. The first movie was The Apple.
Okay, so The Apple was your first movie. Okay, it's your second movie. Okay, yeah, I saw it on YouTube, and I was like, oh my God, she's a baby here. She's like what, 19 or 20 at the time?
Yes, I would say about 19. Because I just finished doing The Apple, and we shot The Apple in England and in Berlin. And I came home for Christmas, and a friend of mine who I'd known for a while, but I was in my hometown. I was a dancer, and we did this big tour with these musicians and stuff like that. So I was kind of in that sort of scene in Edmonton. Uh-huh. And this one friend who I knew through my other friends, actors, musicians, she cast me in Powderheads, knowing that I just finished this movie, The Apple. So, yeah, it was all very, very local.
Yeah, I love the fact that Ronnie Montrose did the music for it. He's a hero in my hometown, because that's where he's from, San Francisco. And no, and he had a band called Montrose, and the first two records had Sammy Hagar singing. That's when Sammy Hagar first got into the business, and the first one is a masterpiece. It's considered to be the first heavy metal album ever released by an American band. It's on YouTube. Go listen to it. It is fabulous.
What's it called?
It's called Montrose, 1973.
I had no idea who did the music on that
film,
frankly.
He was never a huge star, but he's one of the guys playing guitar on Edgar Winter's Frankenstein.
Oh, cool.
And he plays guitar on Van Morrison's Wild Night. He was like a session guy, and then he struck out on his own and started a couple bands. He had another band called Gamma. They were more of a keyboard-driven band, but he played guitar in it, of course. David Ferry is your co-star in the movie. Oh my God, he's still working.
Is he still working? Yeah, he was the president of the Canadian Union there for a while. Yeah.
Oh, he was.
He's still working. Yeah.
Was that probably before or after Thor Bishoprick, who was the president of the Canadian Union Guild?
I guess so. It was probably in the mid-80s that David Ferry was president, I think. It's my recollection, anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. It looks like it was, like, what, 24 below when you guys were filming it?
Oh, my God, I'm telling you. It was cold. I mean, Canada is just, especially that area, Northern Alberta, it's just freezing cold in the winter, you know. But we did a lot of ski scenes and things like that, and all the cameras back then were 35mm, you know, it didn't have any digital stuff. So they had to figure out a way of keeping the film warm enough so it wouldn't break while they were shooting. So they were always, these cameras were always just covered in huge, you know, I don't know, some kind of cover to keep them warm, which is pretty funny. So, yeah, but, you know, you grow up there, it's cold. We shot in Jasper and Edmonton and along the road going to Jasper. But I grew up in that. I mean, I grew up in Jasper and Banff just every winter. We camped in the summer, we skied in the winter.
Wow. And I never realized you were, like, right at the beginning of the Beach Girls.
That's right. I have that little scene, right? That got me my Screen Actors Guild card, that word. I said, who cares? I was looking at that. Somebody sent me a link to that recently.
Was that your first L.A. movie, or was Nighthawks your first L.A. movie?
Nighthawks I shot in England.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I think that was that got me my union card. So I think that was my first thing that I ever did. Somebody took pity on me, and you had to be able to, in a movie, to get your card, you had to say a certain number of words in, I guess, two is enough.
Yeah.
And, that was yes. I'm a beach girl. You know, it's so funny because I used to see in, like, magazines and stuff, and I'd be like, Catherine Mary Stewart, the beach girl. So it's like, yeah, no, that ain't me, honey. It would have, like, a picture of some girl running towards the ocean, and because it was just this sort of...
It's funny. I don't know if you remember Corinne Boyer. Well, she was in a lot of movies back in the 80s and 90s. She's in the Beach Girls. And when I had her on during the pandemic, I forgot to bring the movie up. And then 2 years ago when the movie turned 40, I asked her if she would come back on to talk about it. And she completely turned me down. And rightly so, because in the movie, her and this guy are trying to open a bottle, but it looks like she's giving him a hand job. Yeah.
Aww.
So I can understand why she turned down to come back on. I saw the Witches of Eastwick pilot that you did. Oh my God, what happened with that? I mean, the movie was so popular, and so was the book.
I know that. Yeah, that was a very strange, weirdo thing. It was just one of those pilots. You know, it was a pilot for a series, and as most pilots for series, it wasn't picked up. And that was a very, you know, you look at that and it's just kind of weird. They were trying to incorporate special effects and stuff, and it just didn't really work. I don't know. Ultimately, it just didn't work very well. And they've tried to make a series of Witches of Eastwick since, and they never make, for some reason.
Eastwick, yeah. I watched it a couple times when it was on. I was just like, eh, you know.
I know. I don't know why. It seems like it would be something that could really work, but it doesn't, so...
Yeah, Rick Rosenthal directed... he directed Halloween 2. What was he like?
Oh, he was great. He was really super nice.
That's good.
Loved him.
That's good. Yeah, I've heard he's well-liked by a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you got anything coming up? Have you worked on anything lately?
You know, it's been such a weird few years with the pandemic and then all the strikes. I mean, things have really, since the actor's strike ended, there's been a lot more activity, put it that way. But I think everybody's playing catch-up, you know? It's like, it's really interesting. I've had a lot of auditions, and there's a couple of things that are still sort of in the future that I've been offered, and but there's, it really screwed things up. Everything just fell away and out of place and screwed up with the strikes and the pandemic, and it's been sort of a chaotic time. But during the pandemic, I spent a lot of time writing a script with a partner, which was really, really fun, really interesting,
nice,
stimulated, and it was picked up by a production company up in Canada, but they've since they dropped it for whatever reason. Nothing happened. We were getting really frustrated too, so that's fine. And as a matter of fact, my partner and I are just working on it, just sort of refining it some more, and then we'll try to put it out there and see what happens. And I have a couple of projects like that. I have a couple of really, really interesting ones. One's a theater thing, sort of more of a performance art thing that I've been working on.
Yeah.
And another script. So I sort of slid into that and kind of, in a way, to fill all that empty space that happened during COVID and the strike. And I find that I really like it. I really like writing. And I also really want to direct. So, that's kind of, of course, I'm still auditioning and doing, you know, working at whatever it is I can work at, but what I really love to transition into more is directing. So I'm working on that a lot. I'm trying to think, I mean, the last thing I did was Law and Order. That was just post-COVID. And it was weird because they were being tested every day. And of course, during the shoot, somebody came down with COVID, so the whole shoot had to be postponed a week.
Mm-hmm.
And the show before I did, before that, was just as COVID hit. They had to shut the production down early. And the show that we did ended up being the finale of the season. We were like the second to the last finale, but the show that we ended up doing was the finale. So, I mean, I've been really lucky in that way. I've kind of bookended the COVID struggle with shows with some work. So that's very good.
Yeah. I read that you did a Law & Order episode recently.
Right. That's what I was talking about. The one that I did just when the production was starting up again. Before the strike, and just after COVID. So I'm lucky that I was able to bookend COVID.
Yeah. How about any cons? You got any cons coming up?
Yeah, I'm doing something in October. Let me see. I have it here. I'll look it up. Mid-October. It's called Nightmare Weekend.
Nice.
In Richmond, Virginia. So that's the weekend of October 11th. And, you know, you never know what will come up between now and then.
Right.
But yeah, that's the next one that I'm officially doing.
Nice, nice. Yeah, I mean, this is the milestone year for Night of the Comet and Starfighter and Weekend at Bernie's, so I'm sure you're gonna be highly in demand.
We're trying to figure out something to do to sort of celebrate that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I've been in touch with Lance and Nick Castle, and just kind of hopefully we can come up with something. I know they're doing a big screening in Bristol, England, and they want us to put ourselves on tape to sort of introduce it. I was like, well, why don't this live over? They couldn't afford to do that, but that would have been super fun.
I met Nick last summer at a con. Sweet guy. And I had two posters signed. The last Starfighter poster got stolen as we were taking the selfie. But at least I got my Halloween poster, and there's another signature on there. But I was so mad because I had just bought that last Starfighter poster, and his signature was on it. Ugh, it was terrible.
Somebody stole it?
Yeah, someone just made off with it. I didn't notice it until I got home, really.
Suck.
Yeah, that is, it's horrible. Yeah, it's the first time that ever happened, hopefully the last.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Congratulations on hitting a milestone birthday next month. You got plans for it?
Oh, I know, in April. Yeah, monster birthday. Yeah. I think I might be up in Canada. My daughter is living in Montreal at the moment. So
nice.
She's doing a half marathon like a couple of days before my birthday, so I think my husband and I will probably go up there and watch her do her half marathon and we'll spend a week or something and celebrate up there. That would be super fun. So, we'll see.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, I turned 40 last June, and I'll tell you, it feels really weird because I feel a lot more mature than I used to be, and like I'm holding myself accountable every time I'm wrong now. And like someone told me recently, it's like, yeah, you're doing adulting, you know?
Yeah, you're doing the adult thing, right? I know. Honestly, it's weird, all these numbers that, you know, I'm just like, yeah, this number does not make any sense to me, but whatever, I'm fine. But I just remember when I turned 50, my body just seemed to go, okay, we're done now. It started to, like, things really started to hurt.
Yeah.
And now that I'm almost 50, I guess to collect Medicaid, right?
So yep.
That's a good thing. And I get all the fringe benefits of being old. But I'm telling you, it's like I said, it's a number that you sort of associate with a certain thing. It's not, I mean, 65, I guess, is the new 65 or 45 or something. But it's hard for me to wrap my head around it because I feel so energetic and excited about new and interesting prospects. I'm always kind of like looking for new fun things to do and keeping myself super busy. I mean, sometimes I feel like I'm just too busy
doing
things, which is a great way to be. Yeah, so I am not complaining. I'm happy. Yeah, you know, my knees hurt, my back, blah, 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 blah. But in general, life is good, man.
That is so beautiful, yeah. Someday when you're not busy, I'd love to have an unrecorded chat with you.
I inspire you, yeah. Hang in there, because life is good. Yeah, and talking about stuff, you know, from back in, like, when I was a kid, I have such, like, I was thinking about the movie Oliver.
Oh, yeah. Oliver Reed.
It was a musical Oliver. It's based on Oliver Twist, and Oliver Reed is in it. Of course, he's in it. That's what you mean.
Yeah.
I almost did a movie with Oliver Reed, and I'm kind of relieved that I didn't.
Yeah.
He's quite a character, I guess. But yeah, Oliver Reed and Harry Seacom. But I remember watching that movie and just falling in love with the kid who played Oliver. His name was Mark Lester.
Yeah.
And knowing all the songs, and my girlfriends and I would just be like, he was the same age as we were. And he was such a beautiful boy, and I just loved his story. I mean, we listened to the Monkees. Like,
yep.
Davy Jones from the Monkees was like, forget about it. I got to meet Davy Jones at one of these conventions. I have pictures of all the Monkees.
Yep.
And I am so proud of that.
Do you know?
They're huge in my childhood.
Do you know their manager, Jody?
No, I do not.
I had her on last year. She's been booking their meet and greets and their cons for close to a decade now. She is really, really cool and really, really fun. She's a great girl.
Well, there's only one left, I think. They're all
Mickey.
Them
have. Mickey's the only one. Mickey yeah. Jones. So she's booking all his con appearances now.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, meeting Davy Jones for me was huge, and he looks exactly the same, or he did at the time. I mean, he's so cute. And
yeah, I had a crush on him too. Yeah, I had a crush on Davy too.
Aww.
It was one of my earliest crushes. Yeah. Yeah, I was really devastated. He died, 12 years ago the other day was the anniversary. It was being advertised, and I was like, oh my God, I can't believe it's been that long. I remember I went to my local bar to play trivia, and like I was getting all the Monkey questions right, and everyone was mad at me.
That's so funny. Yeah. Yeah. He was pretty cute. I mean, a lot, when I think back at all the movies, especially that really, really influenced me, it's so funny because they were like musicals for the most part. And they had a lot of dance in them. Like, Spain, for instance, that one about the you know, professional theater school in New York. Mm-hmm. And I just love that. And I was dancing at the time, mm-hmm. but had no concept that I would eventually get into that sort of whole business. I was just so inspired by fame. And my favorite movie was like Jesus Christ Superstar, and
yeah.
The choreography to that was incredible. I ended up doing a movie with the choreographer from that. I was so fan, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
That was my favorite movie ever. And the music and the dancing and all that junk. I love those kind of movies so much. The Turning Point, which is one that's not very well known.
Yeah. And Bancroft and Shirley MacLaine.
That's right. And Leslie Brown was the dancer. And Mikhail Baryshnikov was the... Oh, I love that so much.
Yeah, I interviewed the little girl from it last year, Lisa Lucas. Well, she was in an Unmarried Woman with Jill Clayburgh a year later. She was great in that, playing her daughter. Yeah. My brother's 9 years...
That's great memories.
Yeah, my brother's 9 years older than me, and he had so many of your movies on VHS, and never in my wildest dreams did I ever think that, you know, we would have 7 podcast conversations, and just you'd be just the most wonderful person there is.
Oh, thank you. You're nice, too.
Yeah, I just, it's this whole wild ride the last 7 years of doing this podcast has just been... just truly surreal for me, and it gets better every day, every week, and I'm just so blessed. And I gotta thank you for connecting me with Ivan, because he was great.
Isn't he incredible? He's so funny.
Yeah, I shared the interview in the Night of the Comic Facebook group, and people loved it. You know, I guess Kelly listened to it and liked it.
I haven't listened to it. Darn it, I gotta get that. You send me a link or something. I don't think I listened to it.
I will. You gotta listen to it. Yeah, it was epic. We had an epic hour of just fun in that interview. And a couple weeks ago, I talked to Rick Podell from World Gone Wild, and Duty said about you?
What?
He said that you're beautiful, and he just wishes you nothing but the best.
Oh, that's so sweet. He's a really good guy. That was a fun movie to do, man. I love that movie.
Yeah, you got to hang out with the boys and just have a blast.
Just hang out. Bruce Dern. Oh, my God. What a cool dude.
Still alive. Still working.
I know. He's still alive. Still kicking. Michael Paré, who was just gorgeous.
Yeah.
Every single way. I mean, I was just looking and going, okay.
I want to meet him. I haven't met him yet.
Yeah, everybody was super nice. I had so much fun on that movie. Lovely.
Yeah, I have a joke for you.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Like usual, yes.
As usual, I know. It's funny because I heard some, I think I heard one of your podcasts, I forget, and I thought that at the end I didn't hear a joke, and I was like, wait. What happened to the show?
I most likely was talking to somebody who wasn't like-minded, so I probably didn't want to offend that person.
Oh, but you can offend me. I see. I get it.
You're not easily offended. Okay. Why did the blonde have a bruised belly button?
Oh, my God. I have no idea.
Because her boyfriend was blonde. You got it?
No. Are you going to have to explain it? Because I'm so naive and innocent. Come on.
It means he stuck it in the wrong hole.
Oh, I get it. Okay, he's not that bright.
Exactly.
I get it.
Exactly. Kathy, thank you so much for coming on and nerding out with me today. And I got to say, it probably feels great for you to do a podcast where you don't have to talk about all the cult movies for the 1 millionth time that you've been in.
It's fun. fun no matter what. I appreciate being on. I really do.
Yes, you have yourself a great rest of your day. Talk soon. Be safe. And yes, I will send you the link to Ivan's interview.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I'd love to listen to it.
Fantastic. Okay. Stay inside in case there's a storm over there.
Okay. No, I think on this coast we're doing okay.
Okay, good.
It's pretty clear. So good luck with you guys.
Okay. Thanks, Kathy. Bye bye.
Take care. Bye bye.
Well, there you have it. Catherine Mary Stewart. Ain't she a sweetheart? Oh, God, I just love her. Oh, my God, she was so funny today. Oh, my God, she must have had a case of the giggles today, and she just was just so much fun and spontaneous. Love talking to her. I really do. Well, until next time, this is Tommy Throwback Kovac saying, there's no shame in living in the past because the present sucks. Later, dudes. We do not cross against the light.